Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Vascon Engineers Limited Q2 FY22 earnings conference call. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touch-tone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I would now like to hand the conference over to Dr. Santosh Sundaraj, CEO, Vascon Engineers Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I welcome you all to the earnings conference call of Vascon Engineers for the quarter and half year ended September 30, 2021. I hope you all and your families are safe and healthy. Joining me on the call is Mr. Somnath Biswas, our CFO. I believe you would have gone through the Q2 FY22 financial results and result presentation uploaded on the stock exchanges and on the company's website. Your company has worked diligently over the last 2 years to address the twin issues of debt reduction and maintaining sufficient capital for growth. As a result, despite the difficult environment, we have repaid rupees 50 crore of debt in the last 18 months, reducing our total gross debt to rupees 205 crores from 255 crores in March 2020. The repayment is primarily made towards the high cost bearing loans, and the high interest cost bearing debt has been reduced by 49 crores to rupees 55 crore from rupees 104 crores in March 2020. This will assist in lowering our overall interest cost for the company. In terms of growth, our order book has doubled in size over the last 2 years, growing from 1,000 crores in FY19 to 2,000 crores at the present. We are pleased to announce the successful completion of the preferential share allotment to raise 70 crores in order to strengthen the balance sheet and provide growth capital. We intend to use the proceeds from the issuance to repay about 35-40 crore of company's high interest debt, with the remainder used to cover incremental working capital requirements. In accordance with our strategy of deriving value from all non-core assets, your company has achieved considerable strides. We are pleased to share that we have sold our stake in Goa Hotels. Vascon has sold its 43.34% stake in Cosmos Premises Private Limited, an associate company, for a consideration of rupees 45.5 crores, concurrent with the sale of 6.66% of certain promoter-related entities in Cosmos Premises Private Limited to Royal Orchid Hotels. In exchange for selling Cosmos Premises Private Limited, the company has acquired shares in Rivershore Developers Private Limited from the promoters of Royal Orchid Hotels Limited. Rivershore Developers Private Limited has a land parcel in Powai, Mumbai. The land parcel is situated at an excellent location, and we intend to materialize the land in the near future. On the EPC front, as COVID-19 has taken a backseat during Q2 FY22, all our projects are operating at optimum capacity, which has led to faster execution of projects and resulted in better revenue generation in Q2 FY22. The order book of the company remains robust, providing strong visibility of EPC revenue growth for the next 2-3 years. The current order book is rupees 1,915 crores, comprising external EPC contracts of 1,838 crores and an internal order book of 77 crores from the real estate launches. The government orders account for 80% of total orders as a result of the company's efforts to improve customer quality, thus providing visibility of faster execution while ensuring uninterrupted cash flow. During the quarter, we received an order from the Government of Goa in the consortium with DCS Solar Energy Limited for the development of the International Convention Center at Dona Paula, Goa, on a design, build and finance, operate and transfer basis. DCS is the lead member, and Vascon is the technical partner in the project. The project entails the building of a conference center with a capacity of 5,000 people, as well as ancillary construction to service the convention center on a parcel of land measuring about 28 acres. We remain committed to accelerating order book execution, which will result in enhanced capacity utilization and operating margins for the EPC business, as well as improved cash flow generation for future sustained growth. We continue to take a cautious approach towards bidding for new projects, and prioritize orders from reputed private players or government entities with stronger margin visibility. Coming to the real estate division, as you all are aware, the sentiments in the real estate market had turned pessimistic during the April-June quarter because of the outbreak of the second wave of COVID-19. With the Indian economy recovering, active COVID-19 cases declining, and vaccination progressing rapidly, sentiments in the real estate sector have turned optimistic, reaching an all-time high during July-September, and the outlook for the next 6 months continues to remain positive. During H1 FY22, we did a new sale booking of 13,373 square feet, amounting to a total sales value of Rs. 13 crores. Our new sales bookings were lower due to the fact that the majority of sold out, resulting in lower inventory levels. As previously stated, our ongoing project Forest Edge Tower A and B, as well as Vascon Good Life, three buildings in phase one, to be completed in this fiscal year, and occupancy certificates will be awarded for all of these projects in this fiscal year. We are happy to share that we have completed the first tower of Forest Edge and expect to complete the second tower and Vascon Good Life's three building phases by the end of the financial year. In terms of new launches, we expect to launch residential project in Coimbatore in Q3 FY22 with an estimated sales value of 200 crores. We have secured all the necessary approvals for the project's launch. Additionally, we have a robust launch pipeline and continue to actively watch the markets, opting to launch new projects only when the market is receptive to new launches. On GMP business front, our GMP business is faring well. In H1 FY22, the revenue stood at 78 crores and the EBITDA at 4.8 crores with margins of 6%. Let me now take you through the financial performance. Let me start with the standalone numbers. During Q2 FY22, the company reported a total income of 119 crores as against 93 crores in Q2 FY21, a growth of 28% year-on-year. EBITDA stood at Rs. 11 crores as against operating loss of 2 crores in the corresponding period last year. EBITDA margin was at 9%. Reported net profit of 3.4 crores in Q2 FY22. On consolidated basis, in Q2 FY22, the company reported a total income of 161 crores as against 123 crores in Q2 FY22. And we've reported a growth of 31% year-on-year. EBITDA stood at 13 crores with a margin of 8% and net profit at 3.4 crores. With this, we can now open the floor for question and answers. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Viral Shah from Yes Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good morning, sir. Congratulations on a great set of numbers. Just couple of updates. One, in terms of bidding pipeline, could you highlight what is the bid pipeline looking like and what are the key segments where we are seeing good amount of order book visibility? That is the first question. Second question is on the execution front. What do you feel in terms of execution? When we expect the execution to ramp up to maybe 750 or 800 crore kind of contract for the full year per se? Because we have a very high order book, so which year do you feel that the trend rate can come back to around 750 to 800 crores in a run rate per year? And third is on the margin. Do we expect the margin to be maintained going forward given the significant steep rise in commodity prices? That's it for now. Thank you.
Yeah, good morning. I'll answer your question on. I'll go backwards. I think I'll answer the question on margins first. We do expect the gross profit or the EBITDA margins of the EPC division to remain in the same range that it has been over the last few quarters, anywhere between 16 to 19%. It'll hover around this range. in spite of commodity prices going up, because we do have pass-through for most of the commodity prices with our clients. We do have escalation clauses. Very few commodities are not covered by our escalation clauses, but we are in negotiation. If it is a significant impact to us, we are in negotiation with the clients. So we do not expect a major hit to our bottom line because of the huge increase in commodity prices in the recent days. In terms of execution of the existing order book, things have picked up pace. All our projects are now having fronts at site. There are no real hassles in terms of approvals or any other situation that is putting any roadblocks to progress. So we should be executing this order book faster quarter on quarter. We've already done more than 100 crores this quarter. We did that in Q4 last year, and now we are back to in Q2 itself, which is actually one of the worst quarters for construction industry normally, because it is washed out by rain. We've crossed 100 crores already. So definitely we expect Q3 and Q4 to only take this further up. And to answer your question on when will we achieve 750-800 crores, hopefully if we are able to keep our order book upwards of 2000 crores in spite of what we execute this year, which means we need to order book another 500-750 crores by maybe somewhere by June next year. If we are able to do that, then next year definitely we should be in a position to cross that 700 mark. So fingers crossed, if we need to book about 500-700 crores more of order in the next 9-10 months, which we are working on. And that comes to your question on order pipeline. Government projects are now coming up. In the first quarter, I think all the government departments were busy fighting COVID, so it took the first quarter and second quarter for them to come back to normal business. Now tenders are being floated, and we do intend, while we are still cautious, and we are in no rat race to back tenders and at low profits, but we will continue to pick and choose, and we are hopeful that by the next 9 months, as I said, we will be able to book another 500-700 crores, so that our order backlog always remains at least 2000 crores and then slowly goes upwards.
Thank you so much, sir. So last two questions from my end. One is on the real estate front. Sir, what given the strong pickup in demand in the real estate, so what will be our strategy going forward be, and the kind of launches we are expected in that vertical going forward? So could you brush upon that point? And lastly, in terms of opportunity, road, we are building definitely, there is a huge opportunity which is coming from private and government. So what will be our strategy be? We are keen of taking more private projects, or we'll be going towards more of institutions or government-funded projects? That's it from us. Thank you, sir.
Yes, so on the real estate front, yes, things are looking better. Demand is picked up in the market. We will be planning to launch, as we said, the Coimbatore project this year. We are also having another launch coming up in Kharadi in our own Forest County project, which has been doing very well over the last 10-12 years, and it has already established its name in the market over there. So we have another last phase to be launched over there, which again might not be in this financial year, but definitely in the first half of next year or so, we'll be looking to launch the project over there, which will be almost about 5-6 lakh square feet of saleable that we will generate. So these two launches are on the cards. In the short term, we do have Madurai also for next year, which we will intend to launch. These are all already projects we have in hand. Other than this, our real estate team now is already working on tying up joint ventures in niche. They might be smaller parcels, but they'll be prime parcels. We are not looking, as we always maintained over the last 2 years, we are not looking to create a township of 50 acres and 100 acres. We are looking more at smaller parcels, which are in prime locations where we can develop and sell fast. And so the real estate team is definitely lining up a few of these. So hopefully in the next, as the order book for EPC increases in the next 8-10 months, real estate will also line up a few more joint ventures, which will then come into execution maybe the year after. And I forget, what was the second question?
The second question was on the client mix when you look at.
Correct, correct.
So private and versus institutional government.
Yeah. So at present, our order book is heavily skewed towards government. That was intentional over the last 3 years because the last time we took a big beating from the private client side, and then we sort of are very careful when we look for jobs in the private sector. We dictate our terms. Many times the client doesn't accept our terms, and so we walk away. That has been going on for a while. The government sector, we focused, and today we almost 85% of our order backlog is government sector. We would like to bring this balance down a bit. We wouldn't want to be exposed primarily only to the government sector. We feel that the time now is right, post-COVID and with RERA and all the regulations that have come in, that the private sector is now much more a secure place to be operating in than it was 3-4 years ago. They are also bound by many more regulations. They are bound by escrow accounts. And I do not think the private sector, the reputed players in the private sector, would anymore delay their projects or not make payments to the contractor on time. They would have their financial tie-ups. So we will also be looking at private sector going forward, definitely, to bring down that ratio a bit.
Yeah, thank you so much. That's all. Happy Diwali to you, Chandra. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star then one on your touchtone telephone. The next question is from the line of Rohit Natarajan from Antique Stock Broking. Please go ahead.
Thank you for this opportunity. Sir, my first question is on the last call. You said 60 crore expensive loan, you're paying 15% interest. You're going to repay it with the proceeds that you receive from this preferential issue. When do we see that impact on financial cost, maybe from next quarter onwards? What exactly is that quantum? Because we don't see that number reflecting anywhere.
Sure. So that loan from 60 will come down straight away to close to about 30 or 35 quite immediately. And by March, we hope to bring it down closer to 25 or sub 25 levels. That's the target for the year. We've raised capital and we are using proceeds of the capital to pay back almost 35-40 crores of high cost debt, which includes part of that. Part of that will definitely be going to pay off the Windermere debt as well. And the target is to bring this high cost debt down to 25 crore levels by March, and hopefully by next year extinguish it in entirety.
Okay, so the last time when we had a discussion, you said 60 crore effectively you're paying 9 crore, which may come down to 4.5 crore or 5 crore, I don't know, that is a number.
Correct. With the money raised, we will be bringing down our debt levels, high cost debt levels, by at least 40 crore in the short term itself. So 40 crore times 15% is 6 crores a year, which will be immediately be reflecting on our balance sheet. For half of this year and then going forward, for next year as well.
Okay. So my next question is on the Goa. When do we expect the monetization to translate? I think you have gotten to an MOU. What is the timeline to conclude this stage?
So in Goa, the exit from Goa, we are talking of the new project that we have got?
No, the Goa, the ones that we are talking about, some 45 crore, the promoter.
Correct. So that, see, we've always held a share in a resort we developed in Goa long ago, and we were partners with Royal Orchids Group, who were operating the hotel. We've been trying to sell our stake for a while. However, because we were only holding 50% or 45% of the stake there, we were not getting buyers for a period. Subsequently, now we've struck a deal with Royal Orchids where we have bartered. In a way, we've exchanged our shares in that hotel, which for us was a non-core asset. Although it was profitable and giving us profits every year, it was still viewed as a non-core asset as far as our business is concerned. So we've exchanged, bartered that for a land in Powai. So immediately there is no cash flow. That 45 crore is, it's not really a free cash flow that the company will be getting at this point of time. We will be selling our stake in Goa, receiving 45 crores for it. However, we will be using the same 45 crores to buy a stake, buy the land in Powai. The land in Powai is real estate land. It is not non-core as far as we are concerned. We are still exploring what exactly we can do to monetize that land in Powai. It is definitely worth more than 45 crores. We could, we still not firmed up our plans of what we will be developing there or how we would be liquidating that asset. However, since it's a empty land with approvals to construct, it becomes part of our real estate portfolio. So what we've achieved is moved from a non-core asset to a core asset.
So help me understand that what this 45.5 crore was initially. I think what was the investments to this hotel and now what is that exit multiple looking like?
As of now, the investment sitting in that hotel is close to 5-6 crore, and there are some expenses are also being lined up over there. So that will be so whatever the things are there, we are getting a substantial capital gain out of this transaction.
Okay, so 5 crore was the investment, and 45 crore is the exit that you have.
Yeah, 40 odd crore. So yeah, there will be a profit, 30 odd crores of profit that would come from this transaction, but it would be parked as investment in the land in Powai.
Got it. Sir, then if I have to come back to the numbers that we have touched in the past as well, that is, you are looking to raise the BG funders limit.
Right.
What exactly is the position over there? What is the progress on bankers?
So we have already tied up a limit with CSB, which is now active. So that has got us a little bit of BG and LC limits, which gives us a little bit of float at this point of time. We do have about 30 crores available with us of limits, which will help us, you know, this target that we immediately have of achieving 500-700 crores, that is possible with the existing limits. In the meantime, we are waiting for, you know, this quarter result is good. Next quarter result will be even a touchwood. And then we will be approaching the rating agencies to re-rate and then negotiating with the banks for better terms and for higher assessment on limits. So this is the target with our finance team. They are working on it actively, but it's a process, you know, step by step, which we'll be targeting by March to be in a better position in terms of our relation with the banking consortium.
Okay, sir. Then one more final question, which I have touched even in the past. We keep on saying that 3 million per square foot is what our execution trend is looking like. So if I have to look at that numbers in a realization terms, 2,000 rupees per square foot, 3 million, which translates into 600 crore revenue. So we are roughly working around with that kind of number or expenses in mind. At the same time, our target is to reach 8 million square feet per annum. So which means effectively our execution should go to 1,500 crore kind of number, 1,500 to 1,600 crore kind of number. Is that a fair understanding? Is that a strategic outlook that you have in the ETC business?
You're right. In fact, I've always maintained our current execution capabilities are in the range of 750-800 crore, not even 600. We, with the existing capex and senior management staff that we have, we are very capable of executing about 750-800 crore. We have been doing less than half of that. This year, we will do more than half of that. Next year, hopefully, we will come closer to that, you know, our capacity of execution. So for the last 3-4 years, we have not had major capex issues, nor have we had to increase our fixed cost in terms of senior level staffing. But then after that, so after the next year, then we will be looking at growth inching towards the 1,000 crore mark and then eventually the 1,500 crore mark, as you said, which will need a little bit of capex as well as augmentation at senior level staffing, which we will then do. So we are on that path. See, we should have done much better this year, closer to our capacity. Again, COVID has taken away a good portion of the first and second quarter. We would have done much better in second quarter also had COVID not hit the first quarter, because by the time the clients, our government clients, woke up to the situation and started making payments again, we lost out a month or so in second quarter also. Hopefully third and fourth quarter will pull us through, and hopefully that same run rate will maintain next year, which means next year we will achieve close, very close to, you know, 80, above 80% of our capacity.
So just to you know, reconcile these numbers, 500 crore is in FY22, maybe 800 crore kind of number in FY23, and 1,000 crore kind of number in FY24. That's the way you see the trajectory.
So I wouldn't stick my neck out and project numbers on the call, but yeah, we are moving somewhere in that direction, hopefully, yeah.
Yeah, so, but again, then we come back to the question that order book will it be supporting you, that kind of a, do we have external EPC order backlog to support that kind of a growth trajectory? Are we eyeing for big numbers in this particular year, maybe next year?
You're right. See, I also our hit list, I've always said this, and it remains the fact that we will only execute about 30% of the order in hand in a year. We never manage to execute more than 30-33% of the order book in hand. Currently, the numbers are still okay because we are executing even lesser than that. But as we want, if we want to execute 800 crores, we should have 2,400 crores plus of orders in hand. Otherwise, 800 crore doesn't happen in a single year. If we want to achieve 1,000 crores, we should have 3,000 crore plus order in hand. Otherwise, it is not possible to achieve that with the existing order book, because that is roughly the pace at which activities happen on an average. Some projects go fast, some projects go slow. On an average, it takes 3 years to finish a project, and so one third is what you get in a year. So, as I said, in the next 8-9 months, our target is to ensure we are about 2,000 crores in terms of order in hand when we start next year. And then we'll take a target to be, you know, next year to be closer to 2,500 crores as we end the year. So if we are executing X, we should be at least booking order of 1.3-1.4X in the same year so that we grow. So we are aware of that and we are focusing on that. The banking limits also have to keep growing in that direction to support us to bid and bag orders. So we have all these numbers in hand. We have these targets for each department inside the organization, and we are well poised to achieve those targets.
So does that answer your question? Mr. Natarajan?
Yeah, so I was saying, so the order inflows, you talked about that 2,500 crore, if you have to get into that order backlog zone, what is the big pipeline that you are looking at? I mean, what is our big conversion ratio? Like four times we have to bid for orders, or maybe 10 times. What is that number looking like? Are we in a position to do that? Are we looking something like that?
Yes, so our bid conversion rate, admittedly, is very, very low. We are almost in the range of 1:50 kind of a bid conversion. We do bid a lot, but we back out of the race if it is becoming crazy. Very often we meet competitors who are, not the biggest contractors. Very often we meet contractors who are extra aggressive to bag the order. So we remain shy of being desperate to get top line, because top line without bottom line is a pain, because it ties up your bandwidth for 3 years. And when you know a project is not going to yield you bottom line in the end, just getting top line and celebrating it on day one and then feeling the pain for 3 years with your senior management tied up, we've gone through those situations. It then blocks you from taking healthy orders later when they are available, because your management is already tied up and your assets are locked. So we are very careful. We do not want orders without the kind of bottom lines we want to have. So our hit rate is very low. Therefore, we will be, our tender department keeps filling a lot of tenders. Order pipeline per se, keeps changing. New tenders come, tenders get awarded, they keep going. We keep filling a lot every month. But the target, more than the order pipeline, the target in mind is to bag, as I said, we have the order booking that we want to do, very well, and we'll be focused on that.
Sure. Thank you. That's it from my side. Wish you all the best.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star then one on your touchtone telephone. The next question is from the line of Sagar Bukani, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for giving this opportunity. The question here is, as far as the power land is concerned, how much does Vascon now, and in that, how much does Vascon own in that entity? And, what's the land parcel like in terms of size or in terms of development potential, if you can throw some light?
So Vascon owns the entire entity. That entire land parcel there would be Vascon's. We do not have a partner. This entity belonged entirely to Royal Orchids, and we have taken over the entire entity. The land size is close to about 55,000 square feet. It is right next to that erstwhile Renaissance Hotel. I think it is Ramada now, or at Powai. It's a very good parcel. And The development potential, we are still working out the based on the rules in Bombay, is a good amount of development put over there. The Excel sheets look very good. I mean, honestly, so all that is good if we are able to launch and convert. But if you go by Excel sheets, 40 crore is nothing. The numbers look much better than that, much, much better than that.
And so you will be developing it on your own, or you will, have some development partner in Bombay?
So there is an investment required to get it to approval. In Bombay, there is a huge cost of approval. We are assessing that. And then we will definitely, either there are two, three ways we are seeing how to go about it. In the meantime, if we do get a tempting offer for the land, we are open. However, otherwise, we are looking for a partner who would come in and invest for the approval stage so that, he joins in as an equity partner and then we launch it together.
Okay, because the approval cost in Bombay is actually going to double from 1st January. So there is some benefit available till 31st December, post which, some of the components of approval cost are actually going to double.
Right.
So thanks for that. And the next question is with respect to the liquidation of other non-core assets. Can you give an update where we are as to, those things and, what's the potential value of those three, assets?
So we have a land in Aurangabad, which we are in discussion to liquidate. We do have a party, negotiations are going on. That should get us about 30 crores of sale value. And that will not be highly profitable. I think it is, in fact, slightly higher on our books already. So we might be taking a minor P&L hit, but from a cash flow perspective and from a perspective of getting away from a non-core asset, we're working on that. We also have Caledonia in Andheri, which is the office property, which we have still not managed to sell. We have put it on lease. We have discounted the lease. So in that sense, we have derived cash flows out of it already. But we are looking out to sell it and close out the lease discounting. And the third and fourth are for the Thane land and GMP, which are big ticket items. These are non-core, Thane land could be classified as core as well. On both these aspects, no real movement has happened on trying to liquidate it. I think these are a little bit long term and we will wait for a year or two and then see how to liquidate.
Sure, thanks. And just one very quick question on the Caledonia, what's the annual rental that you are getting?
What's the rental? Caledonia? We're getting about 17 lakhs per month currently, I think.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for answering the question.
Sure.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star, then one on your touchtone telephone. The next question is from the line of Anand Date from Sholin Specific. Please go ahead.
Sir, I have a question on GMP business. What is the current order book of GMP and what kind of revenues we have killed?
Currently, GMP is having order book in the range of close to 70 to 80 crores the domestic, which keeps on moving on a frequent basis. Order keeps on coming and order keeps on executing on the frequent basis. And as of now, the offshore order book is also close to the range of 80 crore plus, which is supposed to be enhanced, but since there is a lot of restriction in terms of the offshore movement and all these things. So it's a little bit stagnant for some time, but we are expecting this order book is going to increase very drastically as because there are a lot of inquiries and things are coming up. So by next quarter, we'll see some upward trend of the order book. And the run rate, whatever the on the half yearly, we did a business of close to 80 crore for GMP. So we are expecting doubling of this business by the end of this year. So last year we did close to 150, so we are expecting it will be in the range of 150 to 160, despite of some movement restriction in the offshore execution. Still, it is not wide open for the offshore execution, which is a little bit delayed and stuck up still now.
Okay, thank you. What are the operating margins we are looking at in the business segment going forward?
Sorry?
What are the operating margins are we looking at in this business segment going forward?
Too much enhancement of the EBITDA margin as compared to the last year, it will be in the same range of last year only. Since the domestic business is majorly the dominant is domestic business and there is a lot of price fluctuation is happening in terms of the steel is concerned, where GMP is partially protected and partially not protected. So keeping in view of that part, so we don't see too much enhancement of the EBITDA margin for GMP this year. This year also we'll have that same range of EBITDA. PAT will be in the range of close to 3 to 3.5 crore kind of PAT will be there.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star then one on your touchtone telephone. The next question is from the line of Mihir Desai from Desai Investment. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. Sir, I just wanted to ask regarding net debt. So currently, I think we are sitting at some 135 crores. So what is the target which you are looking at 2 years down the line, sir?
So we are looking at bringing this down in the range of, you know, sub 90 crore, the net debt sub 90 crore by this year end itself.
Okay.
Then another. So see, our focus, I'll tell you, is to get rid of all the high cost debt. We have a working capital limit with SBI, which is in the range of 60, 70 crores. For EPC, considering that EPC has a high target to grow steeply over the next 2-3 years, we are not in a hurry to bring down the CC limits that we have. Those are the, we will be working on bringing down the rate for the CC limit by improving our balance sheet and P&L and renegotiating. However, we are not looking in the short term to bring down the exposure itself. But we are targeting otherwise by end of next year, that is March 23, that we should be done with most of the other real estate related high cost debts.
Sure. So that would give a good jump to our profitability in
correct.
Next, say, next year.
Correct. That will continue. So already with this infusion of equity and bringing down of debt that we have done now in this month, which is not
correct.
Reflecting in Q2, but it will start reflecting from Q3 and Q4 and will continue to reflect and only improve over the next 5-6 quarters as we keep bringing the high cost debts down.
Sure. And that will also help, sir, to increase our bidding capabilities, no, for EPC business.
See, as our P&L increases, improves, and as our top line also continues to improve in terms of execution that we are doing in EPC, that's what the banks look for. Then we can go back to the bank and continue to grow our limits. So then our bidding capacity will continue to increase based on that.
Eventually, just to add this thing, indirectly, this is yes, as because since there will be debt reduction, improvement of the P&L structure and the finance cost and all these things, so probably that will help us to increase the rating and all these things and to negotiate the better terms with the banks. So in that also, it will help us to leverage better way.
Sure. So my last question would be on the industry front. So currently, being COVID at what the stage currently, assuming at a gradual recovery phase, so in what pockets do you see opportunity in our EPC business, sir?
The EPC business is looking very bright going ahead because, as I said a while ago, we are also now very keen to open up our exposure to the private sector. We had shied away from it for 2-3 years. But now that we have enough order booking in government and that will continue, we will be continuing to bid for government projects. But the private sector is also now opening up post-COVID. The real estate market has stabilized, the demand has increased, and in the meantime, only reputed developers with and reputed projects, more than developers. What I mean by reputed projects is projects that have their financial tie-up in place, that are abiding by RERA, and therefore are very conscious that they have to complete what they start and they cannot indefinitely postpone construction. I think that realization has sunk into the real estate market in a big way. So we are excited to, you know, look at opportunities within this market as well, because now the risks are drastically reduced compared to 3-4 years ago for us as contractors.
Understood. Thank you, sir. If I have further questions, I'll join with you.
Mr. Desai, does that answer your question?
Yeah, yeah. So,
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Mohit Bansal from Ajinkya PL. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity. I had 2 questions. The first question is on the what is our total eligibility in EPC contract? And the second question was on the tax rate. I wanted to understand the tax rate of the company for this year as well as for the next 2 years.
So eligibility wise, currently, see each department puts up a tender with PQ terms, which are totally different. So that's the way the entire system operates in India, where the PQ is desired by the department. So sometimes the PQ is so stringent, or they have certain terms in the PQ that we do not even qualify for a 200 crore project, but sometimes we do qualify for a 500-600 crore project. Having said that, in general, our capacity would be to qualify for anywhere in the range of 500-650 crores. And we would not be qualifying for projects much bigger than that as of now. So that will also change as we continue to grow. But as of now, 500, we've got a couple of projects in the 500 crore range. So maybe 500-600 crore is the highest qualification that we would have currently.
This would be across roads and buildings.
Sorry?
This would be across roads and buildings and railways as well.
Sorry, I'm not able to hear you.
No, my question is, the eligibility is, so you also do railway contracts, or it's only roads and buildings?
This is only to all kind of buildings. It can be from any department. You know, railways also have buildings, metros have buildings. These are all kind of buildings. So metros have sheds, sheds are also buildings. But yes, this is purely for different types of buildings. Not for railways, roads, bridges, infrastructure, ports. No, we are not in any of these. We do not have qualification in this direction as of now.
Okay, understood. Thank you. And please throw some light on the tax rate, sir.
The tax rate for the next 2 years.
I'll tell you, yeah. The tax rate typically next 2 years, if you look at the tax rate is zero, as because we have the carry forward losses. So next 2 years, we don't have to pay any taxes. But prior to that, we have migrated to Section 115J, so the tax rate will be 25% as of now, including all surcharges and sales, once it will be come into that range.
I didn't understand the first part, sir. You don't have to pay any taxes, you said.
First part is, since we have carry forward losses till which is still to be absorbed until next year, so next 2 years, we don't have to pay any taxes.
Till what amount, sir, of profitability?
Though it will be profitable, but since we have carry forward losses, we don't have to pay taxes.
We have carry forward losses which will nullify our taxation for the next 2 years.
So what is that amount I am trying to understand? Because carry forward losses is how much?
It is next 2 years, almost 120 crore carry forward losses which is to be absorbed.
Okay, understood, sir. Thanks a lot, sir, for answering the question. That's it from my side. All the best.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star then one on your touchtone telephone. The next question is from the line of Vinnie Jain, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Good afternoon, first of all. I'm sorry, I've joined the call a little late. I'm not sure this question has already been asked. I just wanted to understand the transaction of the Goa Hotel. And are there any kind of money outflows will happen from there?
Yeah, so the question was asked, but nevertheless, see, the Goa Hotel is a cash neutral transaction. We are not expending any money, nor are we receiving free cash flows at this point of time from that transaction. It is moving from a non-core asset to a core asset, moving from holding stakes in a Goa Hotel to holding a land parcel in Powai. That is what will be achieved in the immediate time frame by doing this transaction. Subsequently, we will then liquidate the Powai land by either selling it or developing it, and we will achieve high cash flows. But in the short term, no cash outflow, no cash inflow.
Okay, sir. Understood. Thank you so much.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star, then one on your touchtone telephone. This is a reminder to all participants connected to this conference. If you have a question, please press star, then one on your touchtone telephone. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference back to the management for closing comments.
Thank you all for your participation. Wish you a great day. You could connect with Stellar Advisors if you have any further queries, or you could contact us and we would be glad to answer them. I'll see you again next quarter, and wish you all a happy festive season. Happy Diwali. Thank you.
Thank you very much. On behalf of Vascon Engineers Limited, we conclude today's conference. Thank you all for joining. You may now disconnect your lines.